Hey everybody, Lon Zibin here with a Plex Pro Week tip. If you are on a budget and looking to build the least cost Plex server you can, you might want to take a look at a mini PC like this one. The current crop of mini PCs that run Intel N100 or N97 processors can often be found for well under $200, and yet they are insanely powerful for Plex serving because they can do all of the hardware transcoding that your Plex server may need to do without breaking a sweat, and they don't consume all that much power either. Some of them, like this one, even have the ability to install more than one solid state drive. So this one's got two, as you can see. And I'm booting Windows off of this drive and Linux off of that one. And if you are looking to get into Linux, these are a great way to learn. And what we're going to do in this video is show you how you can get the Linux version of the Plex Media Server up and running with just a couple of clicks in Linux without having to visit the command line. So let's get to it. Now, a little bit earlier, I installed the Ubuntu operating system on this mini PC. I found it to be one of the easiest distributions of Linux to install. And that's partly due to the fact that they've got a great tutorial on the Ubuntu desktop website to guide you through every step you need to take to get the OS booted up and running on a mini PC like this one. And I found in testing a lot of these mini PCs over the last couple of years that the Intel N100 and N97 mini PCs like this one, or this one, or this one, all seem to play very nicely with Ubuntu and other flavors of Linux. But I found Ubuntu for beginners is one of the easiest ways to get started. One other thing I like about Ubuntu is that they've got an app store called the App Center. And if we jump into here, we can just do a search for Plex Media Server, and with just a click here, we can get the Plex Media Server installed on this mini PC without ever having to go to the command line. So I'm going to install the Plex Media Server here, and once we click open, we can begin configuring the Plex Media Server on this device. So why don't we do that and get our media attached. Now, the media that I'm using for this Plex server is going to be stored on this solid state drive, an external one, which I'm going to connect to the USB port here. I found with Linux, it's often easiest to have your media stored on an exFAT drive, and that way you can avoid some of the permissions pitfalls that you might run into with other drive formats. So now that we have that installed, why don't we open up the Plex Media Server now and get things spun up? So we're gonna click on open here to get things booted up. And what we need to do first, of course, is attach this Plex server to my Plex account. So I need to sign in here real quick. And once I do that, we will be able to take it to the next step. So we're now signed in. I'm going to click on got it here. And this, of course, will look very familiar if you've ever set up a Plex server before. I'm just gonna call this one mini PC so we can identify it easily on my account. We have it set here to allow media outside the home, and that's up to you if you want to do that or not. The next step, of course, is setting up our media libraries. And here is where we're going to have Plex look for media that is stored on this solid state drive. So let me let this finish processing here and then we'll get to the next step. So why don't we go ahead here and click add library to get things started. Now I'm going to select other videos because I am putting in my own media here. But if you had movies or TV shows or music, it would all be set up the same way. And so I'm just going to call this one videos. And the next thing we have to do is point Plex at the location of the files that are on this external hard drive. And one way to very quickly figure out where that hard drive is located is to, at least in Ubuntu, is click on the little icon here for the SSD, and my drive is called Plex Stuff. And if I do that and just right click on here and go to properties, what it will do is it'll tell me where this is located in media/LonZibin. And of course on your system, it will be set to whatever your username is. So what I'm gonna do is just remember that for when we set up the media folder here. So I'm going to click on browse, and I've got root here, but I also have a slash. I'm just going to click on the slash, and then I'm going to find media, my username, and here is Plex Stuff. And then this is where my movies are located. So I'm going to click on that movies folder. And in here, I can see dimmed out the two files that I will be adding to my Plex library. So if I click on add here and click on add library, This will get us going, and we will be pointed at the location of those videos on the external hard drive. All right, and now what we're gonna do is click on Next and then click on Done. And now our server will be up and running. Now I do wanna jump into the settings screen briefly just to look for a couple of things to make sure we've got all of the hardware transcoding configured correctly. And then we'll put this Plex server to the test. And just a quick reminder, you do need a Plex pass to use the hardware transcoder. So I went into the settings here by clicking on the wrench icon, and then I went over to transcoder. And there's two things that I wanted to verify were checked on, and they were. One is that we have hardware transcoding enabled, it was. And I also made sure that the enable HDR tone mapping was checked on as well. Now on the Windows side, HDR tone mapping doesn't happen in hardware. And if you have a low-end mini PC like this, it will often grind to a halt if you try to transcode HDR encoded media to SDR. But on Linux, the hardware transcoder will do that tone mapping for you. And that is a big reason to consider Plex on Linux versus Windows, especially if you've got a lot of HDR content. It can get that down to a lower bit rate and still maintain the proper color. So I have that enabled here, and we're going to demo that in a second. So it looks like we are good to go here. So I'm gonna connect up a couple of clients and mess around with some hardware transcoding, and we'll see how this little machine performs. All right, so now we're gonna jump over to my Mac, and I've got that HDR video here. So I'm going to click on play, and it'll likely start playing without any transcoding here again, just because this computer can play it back without issue. But what I can do now is similar to what we did on the mobile phone, which is change some of our video settings so that we can transcode this as well. So I'm gonna go to here. I think this time we'll do a 1080p at 8 megabits per second, and we'll let that transcoding take effect. Now remember, this one's an HDR video. So what it's going to do for us is actually do the tone mapping along with the transcoding. And if I jump back over to our system here, you can see that it's really not even breaking a sweat here. It barely impacted things. Because we have that Intel hardware transcoding on board this little N100 processor. So now while that video is playing on my phone, I'm going to jump over here to my Mac and start that HDR video in the browser. So why don't we go ahead here and click play on this one. And this is an HEVC video with HDR10 encoding. It's playing back just fine. I'm gonna jump over now to my settings, and like the other one, I'm going to transcode this down to 720p. So why don't we do that here? We'll do maybe the high setting, and we'll let that start processing. And it should spin up pretty quickly here, but in addition to doing that transcoding, it's also doing the hardware HDR tone mapping. So it'll take it a second to queue up here, but now we're playing back just fine at a lower resolution. If we look at the hardware here, we're not taxing it all that much. It barely made an impact in our overall system resources. So we still have a lot of room here to go, even though we are currently transcoding two videos to smaller or lower bit rates, in addition to doing the hardware tone mapping. And we know the hardware transcoder is working because we have a little HW here next to each of these. And what's great is that this little mini PC is not even turning its fan on yet. So we're not consuming all that much power here either yet doing this transcoding in real time. So this is a great example of how effective Linux can be as your server operating system and how easy it is to get your Plex server up and running on one of these for a very low cost without much power to pay for either. Pretty cool. Let's take a look now and see how we can back this server up. Now to locate your Plex installation for backup, what you want to do is go into the Files app here, go up to the address bar at the top, and just type in a single slash. And what you want to look for is the folder called var, V-A-R. And then you will look for another folder called snap. And then in there, what you will see is Plex Media Server. And here is where all of your files will be located, including your application data and everything else. So if you were to back up this folder, you can back up all of the Plex metadata that you have on your machine. Now for updates, it's actually really simple because the App Center here will handle all of that for you. So every once in a while, when a new Plex version gets pushed down, if you go into the manage section here, you can just click update and that will automatically update your server for you. So pretty easy to manage everything here, and you get the benefits of Linux. And the best part is that the Plex server is still running in the background here, but I've got a very useful Linux desktop now that I can do other stuff with as well. So it's a very seamless installation here and very easy to get up and running. And this is kind of the gateway for doing more with Linux. And you might want to explore Docker next and using that for running your Plex server, which gives you a little more flexibility. So great stuff here, super inexpensive. The operating system is free. The computers are so inexpensive, they're getting close to free at this point. And of course, you're not consuming all that much power either. So a really fun project for your next Plex server. And again, I recommend an Intel N100 or N97 based machine, at least at the time I'm recording this video. But overall, you can pretty much have good luck nowadays with any recent Intel processor. That's gonna do it for this one. Thank you all for tuning in and enjoy the rest of Plex Pro Week.